Up until the late 1970s, Iran was often perceived as one of the United States' most important allies in the Middle East and had furnished the country with much of its weaponry. Their neighbor, Iraq, between 1980 and 1990, built up a huge military force in the face of the Iran-Iraq War with procurement from the Soviet Union, France, China, and a host of other nations. The United States had been providing around $1.4 billion of arms to Iran between 1955 and 1971, including fighter jets. One of the most important pieces of equipment sent over in the mid-1970s was the F-14 Tomcat, when the Shah of Iran placed a $2 billion order for 80 F-14s. However, this supply of equipment would be halted when, in 1979, the Iranian government saw a rapid change in structure with the Islamic Revolution. The final F-14 order was kept in the United States, while American engineers in Iran were told to leave the country and take the equipment needed to keep the F-14s in the air. In September 1980, the Iraqi military invaded Iran. The Iraqis believed that the invasion would be a short operation fought against an unorganized militia. The stated goal was to prevent any sort of Islamic revolution from spreading to secular Iraq. However, the invading force came up against heavy resistance and led to the eight-year-long Iran-Iraq War, which saw the widespread use of chemical weapons by Iraq and widespread destruction to civilian towns and villages. During the rushed evacuation from Iran, American engineers had managed to sabotage many of the Phoenix missiles. Without them, the F-14 was far more limited in its ability. The Iranians had to rely on massive smuggling networks to supply F-14 parts from the US just to keep their aircraft operational. And to complicate matters, the F-14 was notorious for its heavy maintenance, particularly in regards to its TF-30 engines. Nevertheless, the underground supply networks kept the aircraft flying. During the early 1980s, Iran had even asked Israel for help, despite the new Iranian government's vocal opposition to the nation. Israel managed to create a supply line by purchasing F-14 components from American dealers and then send them to Iran. This supply line closed when the Iranian-backed Hezbollah militia began firing rockets at Israel. Thus, Iran's supply of F-14 components became even more restricted. Apart from the challenges of maintenance, one of the biggest problems facing F-14 pilots was the lack of long-range armament. With a shortage of Phoenix missiles and a lack of proper long-range alternatives, the F-14s were forced to get up close to their adversaries. Although F-14 pilots saw success using these tactics, it was far from a preferable situation, since the Iraqis had also been attempting to outfit their MiGs with long-range standoff weapons. As the war drew on, the F-14 slowly took a back seat, limited by these factors. However, this would change. The Iranians began looking into alternatives for the Phoenix missile they no longer had access to. One of the primary options was the MIM-23 HAWK, a surface-to-air missile system developed by Raytheon in the 1950s. Iran had access to a number of these missiles, and after some consideration, the decision was made in 1985 to start a research program to convert these surface-to-air missiles into something which could be used on the F-14. Two issues arose. Firstly, both the crew and the designers were uncertain of whether or not the missile would cause damage to the aircraft upon release. It was far larger than the AIM-7 Sparrow the F-14 would typically carry. It was thought that the weight and the massive rocket engine may damage the wing, or at least cause damage to the hardpoint. The second issue was guidance. The F-14A used the ANAW G9 radar system, which was incompatible with the Hawk. Two teams were set up. The first was to be headed by experienced fighter pilot Major Feridun Feri Ali-Mazandarani, who had two radar intercept officers, what we know today as weapon systems officers, and 10 other specialist personnel under him. The second team was to be made up of another 9 Iranian Air Force personnel. Throughout 1986, research aimed at solving these two problems continued. The first solution was to reinforce the hard points on the aircraft to allow for the increased weight and drag of the larger missile. The first flight occurred shortly after, with Mazandarani in the cockpit. He performed some maneuvers to test the aerodynamics and soundness of the new setup and landed the aircraft. Having proved that the F-14 could actually carry these missiles, the next test was planned, firing the missile. The designers realized that the massive rocket engines of these missiles could destroy the pylons of the F-14. The solution was to drop the missile before the rocket engine ignited. Mazandarani, with Captain Mohammed Ogbay as radar intercept officer, set up the scenario to shoot down a BQM-34 target drone. Their F-14 would be flanked by two F-4s, which would record the live firing using their electro-optical cameras, while a Dassault Falcon would fly directly underneath, equipped with cameras and telemetric gear, to record the missile's firing. A Boeing 707 for refueling would also be at hand. According to those who were there, the plan was to take off in the afternoon. However, before the test, the Falcon pilot announced he would not fly, fearing that the missile could destroy his aircraft if the rocket failed to engage. After several hours of debate, without resolution, the daylight had faded and the opportunity lost. Calling Air Force Commander Colonel Hushang Sedi that night, Mazandarani was given the green light to reschedule for 8 a.m. the following morning, with the commander offering his own Falcon aircraft and co-pilot himself. Taking off from Tehran the next morning, the F-14 managed to lock up the drone and fire. The order was given to fire the second missile, both successfully fired and tracked. There remained two problems: the ignition time after release and the effectiveness of the F-14 radar synchronizing with the Hawk. Since the Iranians did not have the necessary equipment to automatically re-time the missile's release system, a makeshift testing method was developed. The F-14 was suspended by a crane, whilst a trench was dug under the pylon containing the Hawk. The disarmed and rocket-disabled missile would then be dropped into the trench, and engineers would manually adjust the timing for engine engagement. Despite their best efforts, the ignition timing issue persisted. The Hawk was designed to receive target information from the SAM radar system before firing. Radar-guided F-14 missiles were designed to receive target information whilst flying from the F-14 itself. To bridge the gap between these two systems, engineers designed a hardware interface which would allow the missile to understand the information being sent from the F-14 radar and vice versa. This innovation was put to the test shortly after, when Mazandarani again tested the missile against a drone, and this time the missiles would be fully armed. It was said that this took place at 20,000 to 25,000 feet, with a range of 45 kilometers between the F-14 and the target. It was a complete success. However, skepticism remained among higher-ranking officers, including Colonel Sharam Rostami, Deputy Director of Air Force Operations, who decided to fly the F-14 himself to test the new missile system. His flight resulted in another successful splash, confirmed on the ground by Mazandarani and Director of Air Force Operations Colonel Abbas Babai, who both drove out to inspect the effectiveness of the drone hit. These tests would continue, finally culminating in an actual combat mission on September 16, 1986. Air Force Command wanted to prove that the missile was effective in combat before expanding the program. Mazandarani, who at this point had 10 kills in the F-14, was chosen by Colonel Babai as the man for the job. After arriving at Bashar Air Base, he took off with his radar intercept officer in the back, First Lieutenant Ansarin, on a mission to intercept an Iraqi aircraft. According to Mazandarani, he acquired a lock and fired the first of his two Hawk missiles, only to find out that the first missile was a dud, supposedly one of the test missiles loaded by mistake, and it headed straight to the ground after launch. He quickly fired the second missile at 20 nautical miles, which managed to keep lock and hit the enemy aircraft, which then disappeared from the F-14 scope. Signal intelligence confirmed a kill shortly afterwards. Mazandarani remembers later being told that he had shot down a Dassault Super Etendard piloted by a Captain A. Kamal Hussein. This was an impressive achievement, as the Super Etendard was known to be a capable aircraft. This marked the re-emergence of the Tomcat during the later years of the Iran-Iraq War as a formidable adversary. So much so that Saddam Hussein announced that any Iraqi pilot who shot down an F-14 would receive a new Mercedes. Following this success, the Iranian Air Force decided to convert more Hawks as part of a national program known as the Skyhawk Missile Program, or Sigil. Details surrounding the program are not clear, however it is known that the missile would officially enter service in April 1988 and that it likely improved upon the initial converted Hawks with a focus on radar optimization. While the Iranian government rarely releases any information relating to these weapons systems, two testimonies exist of victories being achieved with the full operational Sejil missile, although neither have been verified. The first claim is a shootdown of two aircraft flying in close formation using a single Sejil missile by Lieutenant Colonel Asadollah Adeli. Although this was never officially confirmed, it is plausible, as Adeli is known to have shot down three MiG-23s flying in close formation using a single Phoenix missile sometime earlier in the war, something he became internationally known for, even being invited by the US Navy to talk about the event after he moved to America. The second claimed victory, using the Sejil, was recorded by the Iranian military and was highlighted by Brigadier General Fazollah Javidnia in his book Battle in the Sky, in which a F-14 managed to shoot down an Iraqi MiG-29A in 1988. Following the success of the Sejil program, another modification program was undertaken in which Hawks were converted to air-to-surface missiles. This process included replacing the Hawk warhead with the front section of an M-117 bomb. This missile would become known as the Yasser. There is little information surrounding how this missile actually worked, since the front half of the Hawk appears to have been completely removed. From all appearances, the missile had tail fins capable of moving, suggesting that the Yasser could indeed track a target. How this was done is unclear, whether it was radar-guided, beam-guided, or manually controlled. It could be fired at targets up to 15 miles away, giving it a longer range than the AGM-65 Maverick. From the sparse information available, it seems that pilots did not favor the missile due to poor accuracy. Very few were deployed, and following its inability to accurately and consistently strike targets, it was withheld from widespread rollout in the field. Both the Yasser and Sejil remain somewhat of a mystery. Following their limited service in the Iran-Iraq War, they were rarely seen again. This is yet another story of innovation under the pressures of war, a recurring theme in our exploration of military aviation history.